Hey everybody, I've had a couple of viewers request over time how I use my Intel Compute Stick. Specifically, how do I have it set up that allows me to remote into it? How does it power on when I apply power to it? And various other questions. I'm going to cover all of those in this video, so stay tuned. I've got my TeamViewer application up and running, and I've got the IP address of the Intel Compute Stick plugged in. By clicking connect, and now I have the desktop of the Intel Compute Stick. If you would like to learn how to make amateur astronomy as easy and accessible as possible, why don't you go ahead and click subscribe, and while you're at it, hit the little bell notification next to that. You'll show me some love and I will make you new videos. So when the Intel Compute Stick first gets power applied to it from the field battery, it just boots up. I don't have to worry about pressing any buttons or anything like that. If you're in a remote observatory and you've got the ability to remotely toggle your power, that could be a way that you get the Intel Compute Stick to power on. Unfortunately, the Intel Compute Stick does not have an RJ45 or an Ethernet port in it, so wake on LAN commands, as far as I know, aren't going to work. The first thing that I want to get out of the way is you need to have some sort of wireless networking connection already created. To do this, you would just plug the Intel Compute Stick into the back of an HDMI monitor, plug a wireless keyboard and mouse into it, and use it like it was a normal computer. I use a little USB hub to also connect the wireless card that I'm going to be using. If you right click on your little wireless network icon down here and go to Open Network and Sharing Center, the first thing that you'll see is your basic Windows 10 networking configuration. We don't really need this window at this step. Instead, we're going to go to Change Adapter Settings. As you can see, I've got several Wi-Fi connections. I've got an integrated Wi-Fi, which I renamed to integrated Wi-Fi by right-clicking, choosing rename, and giving it that name. That's the wireless connection that was built into the Intel Compute Stick. And as my telescope slews around, sometimes the Intel Compute Stick gets the mount between it and my home router, and it will drop connection. This Wi-Fi connection is the wireless connection to the paramount. You don't need this if you don't have a paramount or any other telescope mount that does not use a wireless connection. If you're connecting via USB straight into it, just ignore this part and keep using your USB. What we're focused on is the ICS Wi-Fi, which I renamed again by right-clicking, choosing rename, and typing in ICS Wi-Fi. Once you've picked a name that you want to use, and feel free to use ICS Wi-Fi if you want, the next thing we do is go back one level to Network and Internet, and then we click Network Sharing Center. The next step that we want to do inside of here is set up a new connection or network. You're going to manually connect to a wireless network. You'll click Next. We want to use the ICS Wi-Fi or whatever name you used. Click Next. Then we want to enter a network name. In this case, I used the name that came on the card for the nano router. For the security type, choose the appropriate security type for whatever device you picked and enter the security key. You don't need to worry about having start this connection automatically, but I do anyway. If you forget this step or it becomes unchecked later, don't sweat it. We're going to solve that in the next process. Do not connect even if the network is not broadcasting. So now that we've got our wireless network profile created, we can use a PowerShell script to ensure that we always connect to this network. The first command in our PowerShell script is the NETSH command. This command is going to use WLAN to connect to an SSID called TP-Link_84D9_5G, which is this right over here. So whatever yours is, you would type that here. The name of the profile is the same as the wireless network. It doesn't have to be. I do it for consistency. The name is this value up here. The interface is the ICS Wi-Fi. Make sure you get the capitalization correct on all of this. When this command runs, it will force ICS Wi-Fi to seek out TP-Link and connect to it. I give it a 10 second pause to allow that connection to take effect, and then I create a variable called $con, and I assign the value of this variable to the result of the interface ICS Wi-Fi. What that means is I'm taking all of the values of ICS Wi-Fi as a physical adapter, and I'm storing all of those parameters into this variable called $con. I then test that variable to see if the connection state is equal to disconnected. Basically, connect to my TP-Link nano router, and if you fail, go to this next step, which is the NETSH command all over again, but this time I connect to my home wireless network. Raven 3 is the 5G network inside of my house. For consistency's sake, the name of the profile is also Raven 3, and I'm still using the ICS Wi-Fi. I give this another 10 seconds for the connection to take effect, and I reassign the values of that interface to con. If both of these connection attempts fail, and my laptop is connected to one of those networks, then I know that I probably just need to move the router or the telescope into a better position, that the antenna can't see the network. It always works in this order every single time. There's no rhyme or reason why I'm trying to connect to the field router first and then the home Wi-Fi second. I could very easily switch those around and make it work. In fact, for the purposes of this video, I'm connected to my home Wi-Fi right now, but it clearly did try to connect to the TP-Link nano router initially. The next thing that I want to show you to get this thing all up and running automatically for you is the startup folder. As somebody who's worked a lot in IT, having scripts that start up automatically to back up certain files is very nice. So I use this a lot, and it was the first place I thought to stick these scripts when I decided that I was going to try and automate the startup process of the Intel Compute Stick, and it's been working great. You can see that I've got four things that load at startup. The first thing that I want to draw your attention to is the TeamViewer host. Every time my computer starts up, it launches the TeamViewer host and it waits for me to connect into it. The next thing that runs is this runps.bat. If we edit this, which is an old school DOS program, it's actually fairly simple. It calls two PowerShell scripts in series. The first one it runs is what I call the power management PS1 script, and then the second script it runs is what we just looked at. This power management script, I'm actually quite proud of. A lot of times we have USB devices in Windows 10 that like to go to sleep or go into power saver mode or whatever, and it's this annoying Windows setting that for some reason keeps re-enabling itself, and it can cause cameras or other equipment to just drop connection in the middle of an imaging session. So I wrote a PowerShell script that every time the computer turns on, it disables all of those settings for you so your USB devices can't go to sleep in the middle of an imaging session. I'm going to show that script to you also right now. What this PowerShell script is basically doing is it gets a list of all of the USB hubs from Device Manager, and it loops through every single one of them looking for that suspend this device to conserve power setting, and it sets the enabled check mark to false. It effectively unchecks all of those boxes for you. So there you have it. Those are the scripts that I use to get my Intel Compute Stick to set everything up for me and be ready for me to connect into it and go ahead and launch my programs. Speaking of programs, one viewer has asked if the Intel Compute Stick that I use, which is the Mobile 3 version, has enough power to run all of the programs we need for astrophotography. Well, let me go ahead and give you a demonstration of that. we're going to go ahead and load up the SkyX Professional. And I need to use the SkyX to control my paramount. Connect to the telescope real quick. Clutches are disengaged. Go ahead and home it. So the Intel Compute Stick is currently homing my mount. We'll go ahead and minimize this, but it'll still be running in the background. And let's go ahead and open up PhD guiding too, because I know a lot of us like to use PhD. We're gonna connect to my ASI camera. We're gonna connect to the mount. Go ahead and close that. And let's go ahead and begin looping. Now it's not going to find any stars, and it's pointed at a pretty white wall right now with all of this light going on. So yeah, it's going to look like crap. But while that's going, let's go ahead and let's launch Sequence Generator Pro while we're at it. So we've got Sequence Generator Pro loaded up. We have PhD that's doing some sort of PhD guiding on a wall. And we've got the SkyX up and running. And as you can see, there's a little bit of latency getting the map to move, which is typically the case on this Intel Compute Stick. Everything is working. Or if we look at Task Manager, you can see that I'm using about half the CPU and a little more than half the memory, which still leaves plenty of overhead to be doing things like taking an image with another camera and downloading it. When we're taking an image every 60 seconds, 5 minutes, or whatever, there's 60 seconds or 5 minutes of idle time on that camera that you're not needing the computer for. And downloading it, saving it to a hard drive is little more than just a file transfer. It doesn't require a ton of resources either. So yes, the Intel Compute Stick clearly has the resources to run the SkyX, Sequence Generator Pro, PhD guiding, and I bet you could do some other imaging and maybe have something else running on it as well. So there you have it. That's my Intel Compute Stick setup. I turn it on by just giving it power. I've got a bunch of scripts that set up all of my networking, connect to the network for the mount. They get TeamViewer started up for me in the startup folder, and the Intel Compute Stick has the resources adequate enough to run the SkyX, Sequence Generator Pro, and PhD guiding. So I hope you found this video really informative, and if you were thinking about buying any small computer for your telescope, the Intel Compute Stick is a good choice. But if you can afford a better computer or a different computer that has more resources than my Intel Compute Stick, by all means, go for it. There's no reason why you have to use the Intel Compute Stick. I simply chose it for its small form factor and the fact that I could run it off of a car charger for a cell phone.